Morning and welcome as we worship the Lord here at Laurel Bluff Baptist Church. We welcome you into our worship services today, and we're so glad that you're joining us for our online worship today. We do have several things that I want to remind you of, and don't forget about next Sunday. Next Sunday is a day that we're excited about because that's the day that we're going to go back to in-person worship. We're at 9:30. Anyone 50 years old and older, we're inviting to come to our 9:30 service, and anybody under the age of 50, to please make that to come to our 11 o'clock. We're looking forward to seeing you there. Also, we have a card sent to our church this week, a wonderful card. This is one that's comes from our brother Brad Daugherty, and Brad says, "Brother Cal, just wanted to send a big thank you to everyone for all the cards and the snacks. It really means a lot to me. Thank you all for the prayers. I'm truly blessed to have a church family like Laurel Bluff." And so I know Lindsay's got it ready, and I'm going to ask her if she wouldn't mind to go ahead and put Brad's address right there in the announcement section and the comments. So if you'd like to send him a card for Thanksgiving to tell him how thankful you are for him and him being willing to serve our country, this is a great opportunity for you to do that, to be an encouragement to him. And so we thank God for that and for Brad and his service. And so as we go into our time of looking for those that have our prayer requests, we want to be lifting up Courtney Macklin in prayer. Courtney has tested positive for COVID, so be in prayer for her. Also for Brother Harold and Miss Pam as they continue to fight the COVID virus. Miss Pam is at home. Brother Harold has been moved out on the floor, back on the fifth floor, and so that's a blessing. So as a church family, continue to pray for him, that the Lord continues to have his healing hand upon him. Also, Emily Patterson, we want to lift up in prayer. That's been diagnosed with COVID as well. Be in prayer for Greg Patterson. He's got some doctor's appointments coming up, so be lifting him up in prayer. I know we've got several folks around us and in and out of the school systems. We want to be lifting up our teachers, especially at this time. Be in prayer for them as they continue to serve our students, and they do such a wonderful job. So if you have that opportunity, let a teacher know how thankful you are for them, for their effort and for their work and everything that they're doing for our children. So also some updates. Miss Amanda Hughes, I received a call right before service today from Miss Kathy Newby that Miss Amanda has been released and is able to go home with her sister right now. And so be in prayer for Miss Amanda as she continues to heal from her shoulder surgery. Also continue to be lifting up Kelly Naramore. Pray for Kelly. And also be in prayer for Miss Vicki Peters. Miss Vicki continues to heal. She fell a few weeks ago and broke her toe on one foot and then fractured her other foot. So as a church family, be lifting her up in prayer. And I encourage you during this time that we're being able, as we start our services, to say hello to one another there in the comment section. That way everyone can see that as a church family, even though that we're separated by distance, we're still able to say hello and worship together and be an encouragement to one another today as we worship. So what a privilege it is to join together in worship. And as we join together today, lifting up our prayer list, I know that you have many on your hearts today that you have in prayer. So as a church family, let's join together in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, God. Thank you for this day. What a privilege it is to be able to worship you. Lord, even though that we may worship in a different place right now from our homes or from wherever we're at, God, we know that you're there. You promised us even we're just two or three are gathered in your name, you're in the midst. And God, we know that your hand is with us. And Father, we know that your spirit is right with our hearts this morning. And Lord, it's our prayer as we join together to worship that you receive all the glory and honor. Lord, that you may bless us and be with us as we continue to reach out in a lost and dying world to share the love of Christ. And Lord, it's my prayer for those that we've mentioned today on our prayer list. Lord, I pray especially for each one that you just may bring healing to those that are fighting this virus. God, that you just may surround them with your love. And Lord, that you may encourage them because, Father, this is many times a long battle. I pray that you may be with them and bless them, Father, as they continue to fight. And Lord, give them that strength, and Lord, give them that resolve. And Lord, for their doctors and nurses, I pray that you grant them wisdom, that everything they might do for them would bring about their healing and best benefit. And Lord, for those that are sick, those that are recuperating from surgery, God, I pray especially for them, that you may touch their bodies and bring healing to them. And Lord, for Brother Brad, as he continues to serve our country overseas, I pray, Lord, for your protection upon him, Lord, for you to watch over him and bless him, and Father, that you may be with him in all things. And God, we know that you're here, and Father, we know that you want to use us. And Lord, it's our prayer today that you may speak to our hearts. God, that you may draw us near to you from wherever we're at today Bless us and be with us. Lord, move us even to a point of decision in our life. If there's somebody today that's watching without Jesus as their Savior, it's my prayer that today they'd come to a saving knowledge of Christ before eternally it's too late. Lord, I just pray that you have your way in our hearts and in our lives today. For it's in the name of Jesus we ask all things. Amen.
Amen. Well, wherever you're at this morning, you can stay on your couch, whatever you'd like to do. But I encourage you to help us sing and praise the Lord wherever you're at this morning. There's a call come ringing, o'er the restless waves, send the line, send the line. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save, send the line, send the line. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, and let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, and let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light, send the light. And the golden offering at the cross we lay. Send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Send the light, send the light. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Send the light, send the light. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore.
We're going to try a new one this morning, that I've not ever done before, but I think you're going to know all the words too. So I encourage you to sing along. This is a great old hymn called The Lily of the Valley. But I love how it says, I have found a friend in Jesus, and he's everything to me. And the Bible tells us that there's no such thing as a friend that's closer than Jesus to us. You know, that there's no friend that sticks closer than a brother, and Jesus is far more than that to us each and every day of our lives. So sing along as we sing The Lily of the Valley this morning.
I have found a friend in Jesus, he's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He all my grief has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. There's a wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
We're going to sing one more this morning. We're going to sing It Is Well With My Soul. This is a song that just been on my heart this week, so I wanted to sing that this morning. as just a thankfulness to the Lord for being with us in whatever we do. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and has shed his own blood for my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. My sin know the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my face shall be sight, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll, the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Lord, we praise your name today. God, we thank you for this time. Be with Cal as he brings the message today. Be with the preaching of your word. May we apply it to our hearts today. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, brother. Boy, what wonderful, wonderful worship. What a blessing it is to be able to worship our Lord. Today, if you will, take your copy of God's Word and turn over with me to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9, and if I could title the sermon today, it would be The Harvest. Matthew chapter 9, starting in verse 35 and following. And God's Word says this, Matthew chapter 9, starting in verse 35 and following. And Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, He was moved with compassion on them because they fainted, and they were scattered abroad as a sheep having no shepherd. Then saith he to his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you, Lord, for your word. And Father, as we bow in your presence today, Lord, we know that you're here. And God, I'm so thankful for that knowledge, to know that we stand in the presence of a God that's so mighty. Lord, that we are joined together in the presence of a God that is so loving, that we join together in a presence of a God that has such a purpose for us. Lord, it's my prayer today that you might encourage our hearts and lives. Lord, I pray that you just might move us, even where we're at today, to a point of decision for you in Christ. Lord, that today that we would make our decisions before it's eternally too late, as your Holy Spirit directs us in our lives to make those decisions, that we would do them today. Lord, let us not wait. And Father, it's my prayer that you just may speak to our hearts and lives, use us in a mighty way, Lord, in a lost and dying world that needs Jesus. Lord, help us to love them to Christ. Lead us now, I pray, in our time of worship through your word, for it's in Jesus' name. Amen. I'll never forget when I was working in Kentucky. Of course, we harvested tobacco up there, a little different than you all do down here. I was listening. I'm just so interested to hear how people are. They work in the tobacco fields here, where one person would cut and then they'd have another one that would spear the tobacco. When I was a kid growing up, you learn how to do it all. That's, you got it in a row and you cut two rows. You put your stick in the ground, you put your spear on the stick, you cut the tobacco and you speared it yourself. And so you cut two rows all the way through. And so it's a little different here than when I was growing up in Kentucky and how we did it there. And one year, as we were housing tobacco, we'd always put a couple loads on the wagon in the evening, or as we got finished cutting, we'd always load a few loads so that we could be unloading while the dew was coming off. And so we were up in the barn unloading our second load. And as we did, here come a guy that I knew from school, Kenny, and he had a couple of friends with him. Now, he said to my dad, he said, "Hey, Mr. Adams, we see that you're all putting in your tobacco. We'd like to hire in." And my dad said, "Well, boys, y'all know anything about it?" And one boy said, "Yeah, I'm pretty good hand. I cut pretty fast, and I know all about it." And of course, Kenny, we knew, and he said, "Well, you know, I know some about tobacco." And then that one boy, he said, "Listen, I don't know anything about tobacco. This is my first time ever." And so, So Dad said, "Well, boys, go on out to the field. There's some sticks out there. Drop your sticks and go ahead and get cutting. There's some knife and spears in the bucket, so y'all just go ahead and get cutting." So sent them on out to the field, and we finished unloading that load of tobacco. And as we get finished, we got a drink of water and headed on out to the field. My dad looked around and said, "Well, where are they and what are they doing?" Well, one of the guys that told us that he knew what to do had jumped in a row and just started cutting, and he probably did more damage than he did good. He never hit the spear. He glanced it off, or they'd split out. And when we got to picking up what he cut, the stalks would fall out and the leaves were all tore up. It looked horrible. We had more leaves on the ground in that one row or two rows that he had cut. And so then we get to Kenny, and when we get out there, Kenny's still standing at the wagon. He had never cut the first stalk. And he looked over at us. He said, "Well, Mr. Adams," he said, I noticed when I was about to start dropping my sticks that some of your tobacco sticks were crooked. So I've been sorting out your sticks for you." Instead of being out cutting tobacco, he decided he was going to sort the crooked sticks. And the last little boy sat there. He was really confused. He had no idea what to do. And so Dad said, "Well, boys, I don't think I can use you." And he sent him home. And that one little boy came back and he said, "Mr. Adams," he said, I really would like to learn. Would you teach me?" And so Dad set that boy with him, and he started teaching him how to cut tobacco. And the boy wasn't fast, but Dad taught him, and he was the only one out of the three that my dad even used to work, because he was willing to work. He wasn't very fast, but everything that he did correctly. And I tell that story because if I could title the sermon, I said it would be the harvest. And Jesus is speaking of the harvest. Now, in our time, we look at harvesting maybe a little differently than what they did there. But the harvest is basically the same. Jesus says it this way, the harvest is plenteous. The harvest is plenteous. And when you look spiritually at the harvest, then we can see a few things. That there are some Christians that think they know what they're doing, and yet they're out there destroying the crop, and they leave a lot of brokenness in their wake. They get out there and instead of encouraging people in Christ, they do everything they can to put a wedge between them and Christ. There are some folks that are lazy. They spend their time and efforts trying to sort out who should or shouldn't hear the gospel rather than being faithful. And then there's others that would say, Lord, teach me and I'll do my best. You see, that boy didn't turn out to be the fastest, but he worked hard and he did it right. And that's what God's looking for in our lives. He's looking for us in labor. He wants us to be those that will be willing to take part in the harvest. Because Jesus says it this way. First of all, he said the workers are few. John chapter 4, verse 35, in that verse, Jesus says in the last part of that verse, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, for they are already white unto harvest. Now, this verse really took a big meaning to me when I was a youth minister and I served down in Louisiana. The big cash crop at that time in Louisiana was cotton. And so what they would do is they had these humongous fields. And being a boy from Kentucky, we didn't have a whole lot of ginormous fields because we had too many hills. Well, down there, everything is flat as far as you can see. And so what they would do, they would take these fields and these huge, huge fields, acres and acres and acres fields, and they would plant them all in cotton. And so then they would come as the cotton would grow and they would develop. Then you would see towards the end of the season, these airplanes that would come by and drop defoliant on these cotton plants. And what would happen is after a week or so, the leaves would drop and fall off. And so the only thing you could see is white. As far as you could look in any direction were white fields. And this verse really came alive to me at that point. The fields are white unto harvest. They're ripe. They're beyond that point of being ready. They're just waiting for someone to come and harvest. And so when Jesus says this, to look up your eyes and look on the fields are already white unto harvest, it makes me come back to this verse. The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. There's never been a time in our society when the harvest is so available. There's folks that are all around us that are needing Jesus. And never been a time in our life when we've been able to get the word out any more than what we can now through all of our social media, through everything that we say and everything that we do. It gets put on somebody's Facebook page or somebody's Twitter account. How awesome would it be if we as Christians took every opportunity to praise our God instead of moaning and groaning like the world does? And if you go and look at some of these people, the drama that they have in their life, they put everything out there on Facebook. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could see the great things of God being published out in a world where we could reach others for Christ? Instead of the negative, instead of all the things that are discouraging, that we would share the encouraging love of Jesus Christ. There is a time and the time of for us to see that the harvest is here. It's for us to be working in. You see, as the harvest time is upon us, we know that there's a time when the harvest will come to a close. We live in a farming community here around Laurel Bluff, and I love the farming community. I grew up in a farming community. That's what we did. Every year we would go and plant our garden and get everything out that we wanted to go. And I know this, that when the frost comes, anything that's not gathered, the fruit will ruin. There's a point of coming when the harvest time comes to a close and any fruit that's not gathered will be lost. Friends, I want us to take that into account today, into our hearts and into our lives, that we've got people that we know of that are lost, folks that do not know Jesus as a Savior and Lord. For us to take that to our heart and say, there will be a time when they close their eyes in death, or if Jesus comes again and they're not saved, that they will be lost forever. The Bible calls this the second death. For you and for me to have that knowledge, We ought to be about the business. You see, the farmer plants the crops with the harvest in mind. He doesn't plant his crops to say, oh, look how pretty my fields are, or look how many I can plant. His mind is always on the harvest. And this is where Christ is for you and for me today. He's at the harvest. His heart is focused for the harvest, that you and I would be bringing in the harvest that has been planted. You see, God is calling us to the harvest. There are those that will not work. They want the wages, but they don't want the work. Just like one of those little boys that tried to help us that year. They wanted the wages, but not the work. My dad set me down one day and he said, son, do you want a car? And I said, yes, sir. He said, do you want a nice car? And I said, absolutely. It wasn't an offer. He just wanted to know if that's what I wanted. And I said, yes, I do. And he said, well, guess what? Anything you want in this world, you can have if you go and work for it. And so that year, I bought that old, it was an old 1984 Ford Tempo that I pushed more than I drove. And that old car, though, I would keep my tobacco knife and spear in that car. And as I would leave school or I would do whatever I was at or wherever I was going, I would stop by and there were farmers all around that were paying incredible for somebody to cut tobacco because some of the other boys in high school wouldn't do it. They wouldn't get off the couch and go out and work in the field. Oh, I was excited. I made a lot of money that summer being able to work for other farmers. That was something that farmers were looking for, and they were paying a great wage. I want us to understand that God's given us an incredible wage. He's given us the blessings of knowing Jesus, finding forgiveness for our sins, living a life of joy here on this earth, and then to beat it all, that you and I have the opportunity to look towards eternity, that you and I have that ability, that joy and happiness in our life, to know that one day when this life is over, that we'll be before our Lord to hear those words, well done, my good and faithful servant. Oh, that you and I take the every moment and make every moment count to gather the harvest that is around us. Jesus tells us here that we're to be praying for the laborers. This is what he tells his disciples. He says, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest that he will send forth laborers into his harvest. To pray for the laborers. You know what I know about God's work? God's work will be accomplished. That's what I know about God's work. And I think it's an incredible thought that God would use us, imperfect people, to accomplish his perfect work. God's work will be done. And what that means is for you and for me, if God's calling us into his service, if God's calling us into his work, then you and I better make sure that we're available and we better make sure that we're doing the best that we can for the God that called us to the work. That we're doing the best work possible because God's work will be done. For if you and I decide that we will not be doing God's work, that we'll not be involved, that we'll not invest ourselves to the point of doing everything we can for the harvest, then God will call someone else and bless them instead of us. I can't help but believe that there's many times that we have missed blessings because we have failed in serving our God. Oh, as a nation, that we have gotten away from the values of serving our God. Pray for the laborers. God will send them. And just to make no mistake about it, not only will God send them, God will be the one to sort them. It's not for you and for me to make those judgments on others, to point fingers and to discourage them. That we do our best and to let God be the one to do the sorting. You know, I had a guy one time tell me that as we were out visiting, he said, oh, we don't want to go to that house. And I said, why not? This guy was a deacon. We don't want to go to that house. I said, why? And he goes, well, they're not like us. What do you mean they're not like us? Well, you know, they're a little different. Okay. Well, what's different about them? Well, they don't live like what we do. So you're telling me they're lost people. He said, yeah, they're lost. They really are. And I said, well, those are the ones we ought to be going to. Those are the ones that as a church that we reach out to. Those are the ones as a Christians that we witness to. Not to judge them, because listen, lost people are going to act like lost people until they get saved. That's the difference. And that's the only difference between us and a lost and dying world is the faith that we have in Jesus Christ. Experience Him as our Savior and as our Lord. Coming to know Him and finding forgiveness for our sins and beginning a new life in Him. That's the difference. That's the only difference. But for the grace of God, so would we be as so many others in their life. That they would be we would be living a life much like them without Christ. And oh, how the Lord calls us to be faithful. And Jesus here is sharing that we're to pray for the laborers. Pray that they will respond. You know, something that burdens my heart incredibly is so many young men that have not made decisions for the Lord. The amount of young men that are surrendering to the ministry every year goes down. It drops every single year. That the amount of young men that are saying, the Lord's calling me to the ministry. You know, I knew when I was 14 years old that the Lord was going to call me to the ministry. And I did everything I could to say, Lord, I don't want to be a preacher. There's a lot of different reasons. I had good reasons why I couldn't be a preacher. You know, the preacher had the worst kids in the neighborhood. They did. And the preacher was the poorest guy around. And the third reason, I had three good reasons, is he had to marry an ugly woman. I thought, you know, that's just the way that worked. But, you know, I the Lord showed me that's not correct and not true. And I'm so thankful. Oh, the Lord blessed me to be able to serve Him. And I'm so thankful that God called me to serve Him. He's blessed me in my life with my children. He's blessed me in my life with my wife. And I'll share with you, being able to sit in my home with my family and being able to see my healthy children, I'm the richest man around. God's been so good to me. You see, God calls us to surrender. And it calls us to have a response. There is a response that must happen in our lives. You and I must respond to the call of the Father. For this morning, for anybody that's watching, for anybody that's taking part even online this morning, that's never invited Jesus into their heart to be their Savior and Lord, God is calling you specifically today. He's reaching out to you right now. He wants you to know that He loves you. And He wants you to know that Jesus died on the cross for your sins. He loves you. And He calls you today to make that decision for Him. To ask Him into your heart to be your Savior and your Lord. Oh, this morning, this is a time for you to make a decision for Christ. As the Lord speaks to your heart today, I invite you to make that decision for Him. I'm going to ask Lindsay here in just a few moments to put my phone number there in the comment section. As the Lord deals with your heart about that decision for Christ today, that you would say, Lord, I know that I've sinned and fallen short of your glory. God, I know that Jesus died on the cross for me. And I ask you to come into my heart to be my Savior and Lord and forgive me of my sins. Maybe this morning that's your decision. And as the Lord speaks to your heart today, I invite you to make that decision for Him. If you have any concerns or would like to speak to me, my phone number will be there. You just call me. And I'll be glad to speak with you. Maybe you're watching today as a Christian, and the Lord's speaking to your heart to rededicate your heart to service and not sorting. That your job is to be serving Him and working in the harvest and not trying to sort out who it is that you'll share the gospel with. Maybe today God's dealing with your heart. I invite you to make that decision for Him and say, Lord, help me. Help me in all things to follow after you. Help me to be available as you call and as you lead. Lord, as you send me into the harvest, that I will do your work. Maybe this morning the Lord's speaking to you. Oh, that you and I would make our decision for Christ today. That we'd make it right now for our Lord. Join me in prayer. Heavenly Father, God, I thank you, Lord, for your word and how it speaks to our hearts and lives. And Lord, I pray today that as you may speak to us and draw us near to you, Lord, that we would be faithful to respond. Someone today that may be watching that needs Jesus as their Savior, I pray, Lord, that today they come to a saving knowledge of Christ and experience the forgiving power of Jesus, the loving power of Jesus, and Father, the purpose that you have for their life. Lord, for those of us that are saved, God, as you may speak to our hearts and lives today, that Father, we do our very best for your harvest. God, lead us now, I pray, to a decision in our lives. And Lord, as you call, that we would respond. Bless us now, we ask it all in the name of Jesus. Amen. Brother Travis.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. No precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my pardon this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this my plea, nothing but the blood of Jesus. No precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. No precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.